Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. We're going to get started. All right. It's so sad that I can't read anything without glasses anymore. And I blame it on LASIK. They overcorrected my vision. So now I'm like an old person. It's a real pleasure to introduce Kevin today, who is our distinguished guest speaker today for our pulmonary grand rounds. Just a little bit about Kevin. You know, I always am so humbled when I read other people's CV, and I always think, why am I here surrounded by really amazing, accomplished people like Kevin Sheth? So after internship residency and chief residency at MGH Brigham Combined Harvard program, Kevin stayed on for an additional 2 years with the Neurocritical Care and Vascular as a vascular neurology fellow. After spending 4 years as an attending at University of Maryland, he was recruited to Yale in 2013 and became the founding chief for the Division of Neurocritical Care and Emergency Neurology here at Yale. More recently, he has risen through the ranks, being named vice chair of clinical and translational research for neurology and neurosurgery, and the founding director for Yale Center for Brain and Mind Health. Kevin has been the recipient of multiple honors and awards, including from the American Federation of Medical Research as Outstanding Investigator in 2022, and as an inspirational leader who's able to cultivate the next generation of neurointensivist researchers, received the AHA Stroke Research Mentor Award in 2021, just to name a few. He's been PI or co-PI for numerous grants, has authored over 300 papers, and has been a sought-after speaker nationally and internationally. To give you a flavor of his many, many scientific contributions, under Kevin's leadership, his highly collaborative interdisciplinary research teams have shepherded the first phase 3 trial to prevent brain swelling and stroke, the first phase 3 NIH-funded prevention trial in brain hemorrhage, and has also deployed the first portable bedside MRI for brain injury in the world. His team at Yale has served as a national model for academic critical care neurology units. So with that, it's a real treat to be able to hear from our friend, collaborator, and colleague. Kevin will be talking to us today about the management of acute ischemic stroke.
Thanks for the invitation. That sounds like a cool guy. I'd like to meet that guy sometime. You know, I don't know who that is, but I'll just say I am just finishing 10 years for me here. I will say in my 10 years here, the Department of Medicine, and in particular sort of pulmonary and critical care medicine, but the Department of Medicine, I have always felt like it's a special home for me and our group, which basically was starting and growing. And whether it was a sort of establishing a modern critical care unit or developing clinical protocols or recruiting faculty or developing joint collaborative research programs, working side by side during the COVID pandemic together. And even now, as all kinds of transitions happen, I tell you, this has really been a special home for me and our entire team. So I just want to start by saying thank you. And thank you again for being here today. I'm going to spend time talking about, I was asked to talk about the management of stroke. I figured it a sort of management update. I figured it was a broad audience. So a lot of it is sort of the clinical high level updates. I'll move through it relatively quickly. And we'll also sort of sprinkle in some of the science that's been happening and some of the science that's been happening here at Yale. I've talked about that in some different forums here within medicine. So we're not focused on any of those today, but I'm happy to, actually, if you were to interrupt and tell me to talk more about something, I'm happy to do that or answer questions at the end. So, but thank you. Let me see, I'll just see if I can move this by, disclosures. Wait a minute, did some of these not go through? Hold on. My disclosure slide didn't hit, but that's fine, as long as you...
That's
fine. Okay, great, terrific. So just level setting on a few things. So just some raw big numbers. 800,000 people every year, stroke, number 5 cause of death. That number has gone down. Actually, it used to be the number 3 cause of death. It went down even before COVID. It went down to 4 and 5 and went down a little bit because it went down, and it also went down a little bit because other things went up. So it was a little bit of both. We're losing, we're going down. That was a joke. Yeah, is that right? All right, great. Yeah, exactly. It has become a developing, as all the risk factors have been deployed throughout the world, it has increased throughout the world, actually. And it is now at the WHO, the number 2 cause of death globally. That is way up. 90% of stroke risk is attributable to the modifiable risk factors. We all know. It's funny, we're all dealing with the same risk factors. Our departments and our NIH institutes are organized in a reactive way, largely so, but really we should be working together on the same risk factors. That's what we're doing in sleep and in many other areas. 50% of that stroke risk can be attributed to behavioral risk factors, such as the ones that we also all know about very well. Just so we're on the same page about terminology, there's a stroke. The classic definition of stroke is focal neurological deficit attributable to a vascular cause. So that's stroke. You then have ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke. In the US, it's about 85% ischemic stroke, 15% hemorrhagic stroke. Around the world, there's a higher proportion of hemorrhagic stroke, especially in East Asia, in part because of some dietary and genetic risk factors, but not for reasons that we entirely still understand. Here, it's 85%, 15, and in particular, we're focusing on ischemic stroke today. Ischemic strokes happen for a number of different mechanisms, and I know the terminology we throw around and gets mixed up all the time, right? So I thought I would just spend a couple of minutes talking about that. There's stroke in the top pie, if you can see that well. That's some of that 85-15 spread that I talked about between ischemic and hemorrhagic stroke. Then another way to sort of commonly categorize this is sort of what you may have heard, which is lacunar and non-lacunar stroke. A lot of times these are imaging definitions, they're pathological definitions, they're etiology-based classification definitions. But as a oversimplification, you can say that lacunar stroke is sort of small vessel disease. That's the consequence of hypertension, hyperlipidemia, adverse metabolic chronic disease, and non-lacunar or sort of either large vessel stroke, so think carotid artery or major arteries of the brain, and then also cardioembolic stroke. And that's what you'll see there when you look at the non-lacunar stroke category. You will see that things like intracranial stenosis in the proximal large vessels of the brain are a very common cause of stroke, especially in Black Americans, especially in the South, and especially in East Asian populations. And there's still a large percentage of stroke, which we say is cryptogenic. It carries other terms like ESUS, embolic stroke of undetermined significance, all these different terms. But the bottom line is we don't know what causes strokes, basically, sort of cryptogenic strokes. And you can see some imaging examples there of what lacunar strokes look like. Small vessel disease, small pipe, feeding at the end arterial, small amount of territory, small strokes, lacunar strokes, wherever they are, deep in the brain, high in the brain, et cetera. We do have watershed infarcts like any other end organ. And the main, in the brain, there are just 3 large vessels once you go up the carotids and up the vertebral arteries. It's the anterior cerebral artery coming off the circle of Willis, the middle cerebral artery, and the posterior cerebral artery. That's it. And at the borderlands of where those vascular beds lie, you get watershed strokes sometimes, especially in the setting of hypotension. That happens in the MICU sometimes for various reasons. So you can get watershed strokes. And those are just all the different kinds of main ischemic stroke features. What you're looking at here is just on the left is a non-contrast head CT of a patient that's 30 minutes into their stroke symptoms. You would very reasonably read this, because I know you guys all read your own CT scans. You would very reasonably read this as a normal non-contrast CT scan. That would be correct. You couldn't distinguish it. And in general, to see the effects of ischemia on a non-contrast CT usually takes about at least 4 to 6 hours, depending on sort of what the severity of the stroke and other features. So you could appropriately read this. We're moving forward to what you see on the right, which I think everyone, you know, you need a neurologist, you don't need a neurologist, right? Because everyone can see what is a very large territory middle cerebral artery stroke. And again, that's a very large territory lesion. And then I would say at the end of severity is something that happens not that common, maybe about 5 to 10% of all strokes, usually in the setting of large vessel occlusions. So again, when I say large vessel, internal carotid artery, middle cerebral artery occlusions that really affect the entire hemisphere of the brain, resulting in syndromes that you can imagine, paralysis on one side of the body, facial droop, language if it's the left hemisphere, neglect if it's the right hemisphere. The consequences of that stroke are usually not just the disability that results from infarction, but the consequences of tissue swelling, hemorrhagic transformation that take typically 24 to 48 hours to manifest. And when you think about stroke mortality, let me just kind of bookmark this for you. So most stroke is mild stroke, okay? 50% of the stroke in the US is mild stroke. You have lacunar infarcts and you have mild deficits, okay? Most stroke does not kill you, okay? Stroke usually doesn't kill, it disables, all right? It is the leading cause of disability. You die because of hemorrhagic stroke, brain hemorrhage is bad. You die because of this malignant infarction, that's only about 10% of ischemic strokes, because of tissue swelling, midline shift, and brain herniation. And you die when you have a recurrent stroke patients like MI patients and everything else, and you have a recurrent stroke, so then you get aspiration pneumonia and a second hit to the brain and these kinds of things. That's where stroke mortality is, okay? Now, I showed you CAT scans, let me show you MRIs. When we're looking at MRIs, I'm just trying to sort of pull out the things like in a 101. You didn't know anything, you didn't look at anything, and you were just gonna look at something. These are the kinds of things you should look at on a non-contrast CT and an MRI. The MRI, how many of you guys have ever heard of in other systems of the body, these sequences, DWI and ADC, just a show of hands in the room? Have heard of them? Yes, raise your hands again. Okay, so maybe about half the crowd. Basically, all MRI imaging is sort of T1 based and T2 based. You guys know that. These are T2 derived images, which basically look for pathology. And I'll just tell you that in the brain, they are enhanced to look for sort of metabolic stress, diminished supply or increased demand. In the setting of ischemia, it's because of ATP depletion, although you can see some of these things in hypoxia or status epilepticus or densely packed tumors like glioblastomas. For stroke, ischemia, ATP depletion results in a failure of the sodium potassium pumps and then increased restricted diffusion of water, which is why then you get a signal on diffusion weighted imaging. That signal on diffusion weighted imaging, which can manifest within minutes of stroke onset because the brain is so susceptible to that decrement in ATP supply, results in a hyperintensity on DWI, or another sequence I won't waste time with today called ADC, which basically tells you that the DWI signal is a true signal and not an artifact. When you look at these things on a flare signal, fluid attenuated inversion recovery, or a T2 based signal, those white spots are not strokes necessarily. They are what's referred to as white matter hyperintensities or leukoariosis, the consequences of chronic disease, chronic hypertension, chronic diabetes, chronic hyperlipidemia, obesity, stress, lots of different things that all converge into that consequence. Those patients are at higher risk for other brain health problems, cognitive decline, gait abnormalities, and stroke, but that's what neuroimaging is. Okay, this is an update talk. One of the big updates from the last 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, is this huge advance that happened in imaging, which is called sort of perfusion imaging, because it's now widely available at virtually every sort of tertiary center in the United States and at many sort of primary centers as well. And what it basically does is that, as you can imagine, you've got diminished blood supply, you've got infarction in any tissue, and that as time is evolving, the stroke is evolving in some people more than other people, depending on variables like collateral blood supply and things like that. But as time persists and you don't have oxygen and glucose, the stroke is expanding. So we refer to an infarct core. You can refer to an oversimplified sort of at-risk tissue around that infarct core. And you can imagine that the infarct core is expanding. What basically happened is now using CT perfusion-based technology and MR perfusion-based technology, but I would say CT perfusion is nice because it's in the ED and readily available. You can actually quantify the infarct core at a cross-sectional moment in time and quantify the sort of at-risk tissue, which can tell you about patient stratification and triage and potentially whether or not they might be candidates for a certain intervention. So we'll come back to perfusion imaging. You heard a lot, I hope about the NIH stroke scale score. This is the commonly used stroke scale score at the bedside, both to communicate stroke severity. It has the best predictor of stroke severity for sort of late longitudinal outcomes. And it is the way in which we communicate whether or not patients are candidates for thrombolysis or endovascular reperfusion. It's a 15-item scale. It's heavily weighted towards motor deficits and language deficits because that's how we grade territories and that's what matters to patients, not exclusively, but at least in terms of some symptom-based pathology. And we use these funny neurological tools like this picture in order to ask questions. And, you know, we got to have some version of, you know, the 21st century reflex hammer, right? So we do. The outcome measure that we use, it's not like in every outcome measure, we use this clinically, but I present this because this is what is used at the FDA for every registration study that has been the case for the last 30 years for acute stroke. And it's called the modified Rankin scale. It is a measure of functional outcome. It can be used at any time points. Common time points are at discharge, at 30 days, at 90 days, at 1 year. In acute stroke, the 90-day endpoint is the registration endpoint. We have never been able to convince the FDA yet as a community of using a surrogate biomarker as for registration. So it is this 90-day modified Rankin scale. You can see it's an ordinal scale, but at the same time, the distance between a 1 and a 2 and a 3 and a 4 are not exactly the same, right? Highlights, 0, hopefully, is all of us in the room. 6 is hopefully none of us in the room. 3 and 4 is a big cut point because it represents sort of independent ambulation versus not. And you can imagine there are all kinds of tools to assign a modified Rankin, but it's what we use in our clinical trials. It's what we use to talk about Rankins. Somebody actually did this. You know, you can sit there and say, right, time is brain. That's what we've learned. It's been quantified in preclinical studies, in human studies. It's been back validated mechanistically in terms of clinical outcome. And I just wanted to give you a sense. When we're standing there, hopefully, and you're standing there and you're saying, all right, 1 billion neurons, 2 billion neurons. There's actually, that's based in something. And just to give you a sense of, to quantify time is brain. The reason we know time is brain is because not only after TPA was approved and used in clinical trials, and then once it went into clinical practice and is now part of quality registries throughout the country, those quality registries, the most prominent of which is probably for us, the American Heart Association sort of Get With The Guidelines program, which is at several hundred hospitals. I think it's relevant in many of your diseases, I think MI and STEMI and AFib and some other areas as well. Is that we could basically in a real world setting recapitulate the time dependent relationship of reperfusion using TPA. So not only does time matter, getting TPA versus not within the 3 hour window, or the 4.5 hour window, which we'll talk about in a moment, within that window, earlier is better. And the relationship between on the y-axis, what you're seeing there is the common odds ratio of the modified Rankin scale, which we just went through, those 6 levels. You can see that presented in a different way in the 3-month disability rate for endovascular thrombectomy, which we'll talk about in a moment, but for both reperfusion strategies. So the point is, time is important, and I would argue that in acute ischemic stroke, this is the biggest untackled challenge today. How we don't get enough patients to the hospital assessed and in time and in the hospital as well. And you can see this, that from 2000 to 2010, I can show you 2020 data, basically the number of people who make it to the hospital and get assessed in time, the number of people who get TPA, despite the disability and the mortality, has been essentially flat despite massive public health campaigns. Why is this? Why haven't we attacked this? I don't really know the answer. We haven't really, I can tell you, I think the answers are, number one, if you're disabled, how can you call 911? Number one. Number two, neurological symptoms are weird for people. So that's hard. Number three, pain is a powerful motivator to go to the ED and a core part of almost all acute syndromes. stroke is usually painless. All of those three things converge in the wrong direction. And we'll talk about this. So how do you, between, I mean, you have disparities and inequities of like EMS systems and call center, all that stuff. But how do you start from the patient perspective at time zero in order to, we need to flip the whole thing on its head. We haven't really done that yet as a community. I think some others do. It is the single biggest clinical problem in acute ischemic stroke because we have these reperfusion therapies that are available. And again, I'm just showing you in different ways all the ways in which the time-sensitive nature really changes outcomes. Okay, so what have we been doing? I wanted to give you a sense of this. In general, what the guidelines and what the field has been doing is trying to make a difference through quality improvement science where that can happen. And most of the things that you can change are in the hospital. So there's been a lot of attention, you know, as usual. I mean, the way I found to get ahead is just to go back and read those cardiology papers from 20 years and then just, you know, cut, paste, copy, and just do the same thing for us. And I mean, it's been an awesome career. And basically that's what we did here, right? Which is to basically look at sort of door to needle times, door to CT times, do the process improvement. You can see here that all of the times you see here for MD evaluation, stroke team evaluation, CT target times of 15 and 25 minutes, door to TPA times of 45 minutes. Those are all based in science and then targets on which we've quality improved as a community and tried to do that. And I will say that here at Yale over the course of the last 10 years, there's been tremendous progress in all of these areas. But again, just to give you a very high level sense of who comes in, who doesn't come in, these are some of the big factors, you know, that relate to each one of those things. This is a paper from the NINDS, which could have come out 15 years ago. We know all the reasons it's coming out now because there's a lot of attention appropriately to all of these issues about health equity and disparities. And they only within the last year or two, but in a very good way for the first time, talked about, you know, why it is that sort of underrepresented populations are calling EMS less. We all saw this during the pandemic, why they're coming to the hospital later. And clearly we need to do something about this. We've been working, colleagues here, colleagues at the Brigham in Boston, to understand like what's happening in those first moments when somebody has a stroke. Why do they call? Why do they not call? Are they alone? Are they not alone? If they're not alone, why is their partner not calling? We even found these paradoxical observations where actually in some of our social network analysis, sometimes when you're around people, you're actually having longer delays. Actually, people are saying, actually, don't worry about it. Your arm weakness is going to go away. It's just your arm fell asleep. It's not a big deal, right? Until it's a big deal. So it is complicated, but we're just starting first through observational studies and then through interventions that we can use, starting to attack some of these things. For decades, we've been working on getting the health system closer to the patient, right? And the way we've been doing that is telemedicine, telestroke networks here at Yale and throughout the country, throughout the system. And we've been using that. Another way in which you'll see that recently is that there have been these ideas, the single rate limiting step for TPA is basically ruling out blood. There hasn't been sort of a plasma biomarker way to do that yet. There have been a lot of efforts, but nobody has been able to do it with sufficient precision that would justify a clinical sort of administer, no administer decision to TPA, which you obviously wouldn't want to do in a hemorrhage patient. So an image to rule out blood, not rule in infarct, has been the primary rate limiting step. There were first pioneered in Europe and then brought to the US at UT Houston, this idea of basically putting a mobile CT scanner in an ambulance. That was pioneered at UT Houston. There are now something like 15 or 20 units around the country at various hospitals. Most of these efforts, I would say, have been funded by the health system or by philanthropy. They haven't been like a diagnosis, you know, code yet for reimbursement. So it's been challenging to get a lot of uptake, but they have been also tested in clinical trials. This was a New England Journal paper we and others were a part of just a couple of years ago that was published that basically looked at systems before and after, on and off of putting in a CT scanner and looking, recapitulating those relationships, which we already know are solid, which is that if you put the CT scanner in the ambulance in the field, can you make the assessment faster? Yes. Can you administer TPA more frequently? Yes. Could you do so safely and more effectively than actually waiting until you get to the hospital? Yes, yes, and yes. These are those modified Rankin, these are called Grotta bars. This is the way we look at all of our stroke outcome studies. You want to be more on the left side, right towards zero and having less disability, not on the right side towards six and death. You can see that the mobile stroke unit has more zeros and ones than they do on the EMS side. So these things work. They're now more and more health systems are getting them, the operational logistic, cost effectiveness kinds of challenges are sort of today what's in the way. And we'll see, is this the answer? I don't know, it's a big debate.
We have it in Connecticut.
We don't. We have it in Massachusetts, we have it in Long Island, we have it in, we do not. Yeah. So treatment options. So basically, we'll just give you a quick primer and review on this. So there's TPA, and the bottom line is from old data, TPA you can administer up to 4.5 hours as long as you rule out a hemorrhage in almost anybody who you suspect a stroke. It's actually quite simple. Tenecteplase is a newer agent that has come out just in the last few years. Tenecteplase, is everybody familiar with tenecteplase here already? So then I won't go over the history of that. But tenecteplase has been compared head-to-head with alteplase in a variety of stroke populations. And in general, it's faster. It's a single bolus. We don't need to drip and ship. It does seem to have either comparable or actually improved efficacy on neurological outcomes. And it does seem to have inconsistently a little bit, maybe a better safety profile. It's hard because those event rates are so small. But the bottom line is it seems to be safe or better and easier to administer. We have recently switched to tenecteplase about 1 to 2 years ago for our stroke cases. And that's happening more and more throughout the country. The field did dramatically change in about 2014 or 15. When there were a series of 7 New England Journal trials that showed that endovascular reperfusion, not instead of, but either when you couldn't get TPA or in addition to TPA for a large vessel occlusion could be performed, it dramatically improved outcomes at a huge effect sizes. And that sort of revolutionized, I think, having cath labs at centers throughout the country. We do too. The issue is that who exactly should go to the cath lab is a little bit of a moving target. And that's where we use these perfusion imaging profiles. And the bottom line there is if somebody has a small core and a large occlusion, but a large area of at-risk tissue, there's something to save. It's worth going in. You can imagine if they have a very large core and a small area of perfusion deficit, then going in to reperfuse a very large core might have more harm than it does good. So that's the general way in which we use this kind of real-time perfusion imaging, which gets pushed to all of our phones when we're on stroke call and we analyze that imaging. There are lots of details and advances now that are happening in mechanical thrombectomy. There are these devices called stent retrievers. They're aspiration devices. We're doing, again, what the interventional cardiologists were doing. They're all the different doohickeys. They would kill me if I said that. But we're comparing the doohickeys against each other. We should. They're getting better and better with next generation. They're having conversations about whether or not you can deploy medical adjuvants on top of these. So that's a very young field, very exciting area. There are questions in and around the cath lab. What do you do for the blood pressure management of these patients? It's just one of the many examples. I highlight this because Nils Peterson, who many of you interact with, one of our other neurointensivists, initially had a K award and now has our level funding to pursue a lot of this. And before, what we would do, I'll tell you the secret, is we would just make it up, honestly, what we would do in terms of the blood pressure goals, right? And you can imagine every patient is different. And so this is that debate that we're all having in different settings about, do you sort of personalize blood pressure therapy or do you have group level targets or do you do both? What Nils has identified is that even transient drops in blood pressure detected episodically or in area under the curve measurements correlated with increased infarct volume, and that translated into worse clinical outcomes. And so he's really been one of the first that has demonstrated that those relationships exist. They exist in the acute setting and they also exist in the cath lab. And that's the data that you're seeing here. Just an example of some of the data capture that we do in our cath lab cases. And that when you have an increased blood pressure drop or lower blood pressure, the infarct grows more, and that translates into a worst modified Rankin scale outcome. Now, the question is, if you have an intervention against that, can you actually change that history? And those trials are actually ongoing, right? Being designed and ongoing right now. This is just an example of the magnitude of effect of some of those endovascular studies that I cited. This was the very first one called Mr. Clean, the Mr. Clean study from Europe. And you can what I want to highlight here is huge effect sizes. Remember, that's good if you have a large vessel occlusion, but I told you that ultimately that's about 15% of patients. So that's great, but we still have all the mild stroke patients, which beyond TPA, we don't have much to offer, anything to offer. This is real world data. This is a true example of glass half full or glass half empty, right? So if you look at the top grotta bars, what you'll see if you have endovascular treatment and TPA, you can actually get very good outcomes even compared to just TPA. However, even with successful reperfusion, about 50 to 60% of patients in the real world still have some significant disability after stroke. So we do have to now figure out how to extend the gains of endovascular reperfusion. When you have malignant edema, that edema that I talked about in some of those cases, what can you do? Well, we can do this morbid but life-saving decompressive craniectomy procedure that helps prevent against the consequences of midline shift and herniation. These were three European trials in the mid-2000s that proved that at huge effect sizes. So yes, surviving with disability, although these patients did, the ones who survived, have long-term improvement in disability, but it's a morbid procedure. So it's life-saving, that's what it is. When we start thinking about the next phase of where we're going, well, if you think about this, you know, in the brain, we have to think about the neurovascular unit, right? So you have the capillary endothelial cell, the parasites, the blood vessel, we have our neurons, we have glial cells, astrocytes and oligodendrocytes. And we have, like we do in all of our diseases, reperfusion and some demarcation of primary injury and then secondary injury, right? What have we done for secondary injury and what are different ways to think about it? Well, we've focused today on the hyperacute phase, but even in the minutes, initial minutes, we're seeing lots of different measures well-characterized now from plasma levels and from brain tissue samples, inflammation, and in the subacute phase, inflammation and recovery challenges and targets that have begun to be identified. One thing that has been frustrating, I would say, certainly in the field, and I think everybody knows, is that acute neurology has not been a good place for pharmaceutical companies, and there hasn't been a positive trial of neuroprotection in stroke yet. And part of that, you could spend an hour talking about that, is probably for a lot of different reasons. Evolution of the science, systems of care, being able to sort of phenotype patients. I will tell you one design problem I think we've done in stroke is that in the interest of recruitment generalizability, we've often gone broad to get to the wrong finish line very quickly. And we see this in a bunch of disease areas. I would say we've been guilty of the field is doing this, as opposed to doing what we did do successfully in reperfusion, which is first finding out the sort of relatively well phenotyped homogeneous population that has variance in their disease outcome, showing that you can have a proof of concept there and then figuring out how broad you can go. But ultimately it's conjecture because we need to have a proof first to figure out how the proof works. That's where the field has been stuck, but I would tell you it's making a lot of progress that we're not delving into today. I just want to give you a little taste of that here at the end. In the world right now, there are two active phase three programs that are going to read out, and let's see, hopefully we'll see what happens. One of them is going to be presented, we'll see what the results are. This top line story of neurinotide will be presented next week at the World Stroke Congress after about a decade's worth of clinical work and in a series of trials. Neurinotide is an NMDA receptor peptide that has been a long history in non-human primate models of showing very good data. It then went to clinical studies where it did very well. And in this study, which was published in The Lancet several years ago, it missed the primary endpoint. I'd be curious to what the reactions are. And that was the problem was the post hoc problem that was identified, which was that the drug actually interacted with TPA and TPA chewed up the drug. So a lot of questions about why that was not identified during preclinical development, but it wasn't. And when they looked in the non-TPA treated subgroup of patients, there was a positive signal. Now, whether or not that's a true observation or not, who knows? The company and the federal agencies were able to raise money to do a follow-on trial That trial will be presented next week, and we'll see what happens. Yeah,
Kevin,
Clark, yeah.
So when you say extend the gains from endovascular therapy, are you targeting that at risk, the number of brain tissue, or further down?
One question has been, first of all, for neuroprotection, should you go broad into all stroke, or what is the subgroup? Nobody knows the right answers. Nobody's done it. The, I would say, overriding hypothesis is in the field is to prove neuroprotection in the patients who are getting endovascular reperfusion. So that's the time at what's being administered, those hours, the first 24 hours. Some of these targets are going after neurons. Some of them are going after inflammatory targets. All the cell types that I mentioned, they're all being tested at various stages of development. This one is focused on neurons, okay? That's this one. The second one, which we've had the privilege of being involved with, which I presented, I think, in different forms here, is glibride, that's focused on edema formation and inflammation and happens to work on a receptor subtype that many of you know, the SUR1, not the SUR1 in the islet cells of the pancreas, but an SUR, the same SUR1 that's expressed on all cell types of the neurovascular unit in the brain, where it co-associates with a different sort of regulatory subunit, but is the endogenous target, the sulfonylureas, the same sulfonylureas that are used, and at lower doses administered intravenously, does appear to affect protection on the capillary endothelial cell, on the neuron, and on the glial cell, because SUR1 is expressed not constitutively, but in the setting of ATP depletion in each of those injury states. We had a encouraging phase 2 trial, and we'll be reading out our phase 3 trial in about a month from now. So we'll see. We'll see. What are other targets you're asking, Clark? What are other kinds of targets? So I'm going to give you, I can tell you the whole history of failures. I'm going to tell you about the ones that are moving forward and that, you know, maybe we're a little bit excited about. There is, you guys are familiar, this is a system, you know, toll-like receptor 4 and the APTOL story. So this is a damage-associated molecular pattern, DAMP, one of the DAMP mediators that's implicated in brain injury, a TLR4 antagonist after being validated in clinical models. We could talk about our preclinical models. It's a single-strand DNA aptamer, and it was recently, it went through phase 1 human studies, and at the International Stroke Conference last year and just recently published in JAMA Neurology, there was sort of a phase 1B, phase 2A study, which showed actually in patients who received this TLR4 antagonist, a 40% reduction in final infarct volume, what for what that's worth, and that did seem to correlate with an MRS improvement. It's now moving forward in sort of either a proper phase 2 or phase 2-3 study that's being designed right now. We're struggling and trying to find novel ways to think about what are, in a development program, the right intermediate endpoints for a particular pathway that can get us to a phase 3 study. This is another one with another agent that you might be familiar with, especially, I would say, the older folks. Remember Zygris and activated protein C that was tested for sepsis. And we know the major problem there was bleeding. Well, there was a major problem was bleeding, as I recall. APC was modified and a mutant form was made such that the hemorrhage effects could go down. And there were always, it was always working at the intersection of inflammation and the hemostasis pathway, but in a way that was thought to be brain protective as well. So that was developed in a number of different sort of preclinical programs. And what I bring this up because it's Zygris or a modern version of Zygris, but also what was done, interestingly, in the early phase human studies was actually looking at the very small event rates of even imaging hemorrhagic transformation as a potential pharmacodynamic effect of signal, not necessarily of clinical, of what it would translate into clinical benefit. I don't know if that's the right strategy or not. The event rates are so low. The relationship with clinical outcome is a little bit, is not as well defined, but nevertheless, as a PD marker and a go, no-go marker, it's being considered and is now moving into advanced clinical trials in stroke as well. So that's another one I wanted to mention. You can't talk about brain stuff without wondering whether or not stuff gets into the brain. And so for some of these things, you can imagine, you know, in the endothelium, it's a problem. It's not a problem, but certainly if you're talking about neurons and astrocytes, we can have all the conversations about blood-brain barrier and transporters and small molecules and peptides and large molecules and antibodies. And I would say that there have been folks who have been working on this for years. Here, Jingbing Zhao, who's a biomedical engineer in neurosurgery, initially sort of trained in Mark Saltzman's lab, so I was very familiar with this audience, you know, has been working on really exciting novel nanoparticle formulations, both in terms of their chemical composition and formulation, and also in terms of their origin. Many of these are plant-based compounds that also have natural antioxidant properties. And so he's using some of these antioxidant compounds with potential candidate molecules like glyburide in order to package a chariot and cargo together for something that gets into the brain, improves target engagement, and actually improves efficacy. Whether or not this is the rate limiting step, and this is something that we need, again, that's a lot of questions behind that. But these are just in preclinical models of ischemia, reperfusion, and stroke, where we took our favorite drug, glyburide, but we also took the other guy's favorite drug, neurinotide, the NMDA receptor peptide, and we saw, compared to free drug, we had more target engagement, more brain barrier penetration. We haven't, in our preclinical model, seen any other safety or off-target effects that we can appreciate, and it does seem to be associated with improved efficacy. So we've been continuing to develop that program, and you know, we'll see what happens with that. You find crazy stuff and crazy places. I think everyone in this room, right, has been watching this, they nods, crazy stuff, the BrainX program you guys are familiar with. Can I take, no? I'll just mention for the maybe some of the trainees or others that may not know it as much, you know, Inad is a developmental neuroscientist, a basic fundamental neuroscientist. A couple of years ago, in order to develop a tool that he could use for what he's really interested in, which is the brain and how the brain comes to be, and how different cell types form and migrate and evolutionary differences, developed this program in order to map. There are these technical limitations in being able to map the connectome, or the connections between and across neurons and glial cells. That story went down a huge rabbit hole in his lab. And a few years ago, they published this big Nature paper about pigs that had VF arrest, essentially a cardiac arrest model. But the remarkable thing was that then they were left without perfusion for as long as 4 hours. And I can tell you now they've gone out to 24 hours and 48 hours. They created, I'm not doing this justice, I'll call it a highly modified ECMO circuit. They actually had ECMO as a positive control, where they, through an iterative process, changed the pulsatile part of the pulsatile perfusion system, and also created this cocktail of neuroprotective compounds. And even with that long delay, they were actually able to show transcriptomic level, cellular level, organ level evidence of recovery after initially ex vivo, but later in a follow-up Nature paper with 24 hours in the brain and in the organs, in systemic organs, actually evidence of the same kind of protection with 24 hours without seeing sort of energy supply. That was thought to be crazy and remarkable. I would say that we haven't sort of, from a brain perspective, we haven't changed the fluids that we've been giving and how we've been resuscitating patients in about 100 years, actually. I don't know if this is a right approach, but I will tell you that we are just starting to work on this in a preclinical stroke model that we've developed in collaboration with Neynad's lab and many others here in a porcine model of stroke. I know I'm just up against time here. So I just want to give you at a very high level what they've been doing and what we're starting to do in stroke, and we'll see. The last thing you guys have seen this been wheeling around the MICU. This is now FDA approved with Yale data, with our data, actually. We've had a series of publications. The fundamental innovation was using very low field technology. These are 64 millitesla. We went in the opposite direction of 3T and 7T and 10T, and that makes it portable, which makes us go to novel settings like the intensive care unit, like the ED. We've been involved in this 18-month process. We're almost there. I tell you, this is a talk about acute stroke. We're working with Paul Bernstein and others to try to get this at Cornell Scott. We think technology, often we all know, increases disparities, but we think if we can take portable MR technology to places like Cornell Scott, then we can diagnose sort of brain health problems in the community. A lot of challenging issues about that, returning information, working with people in the community. So we've been doing this with our health equity office, with the community advisory board, with the folks that work at Cornell Scott, many of the residents that have been involved. We haven't gotten the scanner there yet, but we're hoping to do that in a responsible way. And we think it's a chance for us to lead and to not have technology exacerbate disparities. We'll see where that goes. So I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was an amazing whirlwind tour. I learned so much, and it was a really engaging talk. I'm opening up for questions, comments, first from the audience here, and we'll be sort of monitoring the chat as well. Jonathan, this is where I get to play game show host.
Thanks, Kevin. That was a great talk. Much like in the cardiac arrest literature, there's an emerging field on in-hospital cardiac arrest versus outside. Can you tell us, particularly for this group, what the known differences there are for in-hospital stroke versus sort of outside hospital? I know a lot of your data is outside, but we certainly see it, and it's, although it can be delayed again because of sort of acuity of illness, particularly in the ICU environment. But what's known about that, and is there any differences, and is the field sort of progressing the same way? Thanks.
There was, for the first time, a systematic sort of American Heart Association scientific statement on in-hospital stroke, which was just published, in case I mentioned, just within the last couple of years. And I know not me, but several of our colleagues in neurology were part of it. And so there is it's really good, and there is some stuff there. In general, what I would say, what has been recapitulated and demonstrated, not to take it for granted, all of the relationships between that are time-dependent for natural history, time-dependent with regard to outcome, so they all have held true and been proven sort of in the in-hospital setting. That's sort of number one, so just to say that. Number two, I think as we know, and we're not so different, the quality metric science in terms of sort of time to getting to those interventions has been challenging in the hospital, oftentimes more challenging for all the reasons that we know. Just think about our million RRTs and the false positive, false negatives, and you know, getting everything together. There's huge variation across hospitals, and in that variation, the hospitals that have a better 24-hour 7 setup have better process times and better clinical outcomes when they do have in-hospital stroke patients. When you compare the overall pool, like for many other diseases, the overall pool of outcomes do not track as well as the outpatient population because they're in the hospital and it's a sicker, sicker group in the first place by baseline demographics and comorbidity. Does that answer your question? What other aspects?
So, I don't know if repeat the question.
Yeah, sorry. I think the question is the etiology of the in-hospital stroke different than the outpatient? The ischemic hemorrhagic stroke is different. The hemorrhage one is a little bit higher. There are more hemorrhagic strokes. When you're looking at ischemic stroke subtype, I don't know if the breakdown differs or not. I would speculate that they're more cardioembolic strokes because they're more sort of cardiac reasons why it's an enrichment for in-hospital, but I don't know if that's a data true statement or not. I don't know the answer.
Kevin, seems like from your talk, the real bang for the buck is trying to get people to the hospital sooner in terms of improving, getting them TPA, getting them endovascular therapy. For the large vessel occlusions, right. The work that we've done together in acute stroke has sort of targeted apnea because of the physiologic sequela, the hypoxia, the blood pressure swings that happen in it, to try to protect that at-risk region of the brain. And we have some data that there may be some improvement in stroke severity and perhaps recovery. But I'm sort of interested in that more downstream, that great slide that you had, trajectory, the sort of plasticity, neurogenesis, how the brain rewires itself. Sleep obviously plays a major role in brain health in general, cognitively and so forth. But do you have a sense of how that improving and targeting that in that more subacute setting may help improve recovery, may help improve plasticity and rewiring?
we didn't talk at all today, we're talking about acute stroke, about recovery. You know, the prevalent stroke is on the order of 10 to 20 million Americans sort of every year. The demarcations are either artificial or not scientifically super well defined. I mean, macrophage phenotypes changing in the acute subacute stage, what's happening with collateral flow and the final infarct volume, and then sort of what relates to plasticity. Most stroke recovery does seem to happen within the first 3 months. All of the factors and what they can be modified, how they can be modified, of which targets they modified. So whether or not sleep helps at the circuit level or helps at the perfusion level, we don't know. We haven't had the phenotyping available. I mean, some of the work that we have in our trial, we're looking at sort of acute sleep interventions on the acute side of the recovery trial. We'll hopefully identify those things. Those kinds of studies have just been coming online in the last few years. The work that we're doing, you're doing in sleep, I think is like, you know, is the work in the country. In each of the risk factors and for acute injury, I think those programs are just going on right now. We don't really know much, but it is where the field is going.
So you mentioned fleetingly BrainX. So where do you see the role? Let's say, okay, beyond the fantasy of making pigs great again, what would be the clinical trials? What would be the niche populations that you try it on?
When it comes to brain protection? Yeah. Oh, yeah, sure. So, What are the niche trials for BrainX, you know, for brain protection? They're really two populations. One would be cardiac arrest. We could talk about the barriers to getting there. One would be the cardiac arrest. On the one side, we've had about 5 neuroprotection trials in cardiac arrest around the world last 2 decades. So, you know, that would be one. The second one would be the large vessel occlusion population. And to start giving it to these patients, remember, most of these patients present to outside hospitals. One thing the field is just starting to do is, it's a logistical thing, but administer neuroprotection at the outside hospital like we do TPA in trials. That's a logistical challenge, but that's what.
So in some ways, it's really cool because actually in many places now, you perfuse organs quickly to maintain them for transplant.
Same concept.
Yeah, same concept.
Same concept.
Just an excellent presentation, and thank you. Appreciate it. So you mentioned these mobile units and that they're working with this in Massachusetts and Rhode Island. Have you had any input on the results, and why don't we have it in Connecticut, and are you seeking it, or do we know if it's really that effective? Maybe speak to that a bit. And then the other question I had was, among these interventions that you mentioned, you suggested that we have to be really careful how you time it relative to TPA, and maybe give us some idea where you see, as Dr. Kaminsky said, this going in the future.
Yeah. So two questions there, one about the mobile unit and one about sort of timing of sort of novel interventions. With regard to the mobile unit piece, what I would say is now there have been sort of multiple trials that have been published in multiple sort of geographies, Europe and North America, where it works from a clinical efficacy perspective. So it works clinically. The question really is on scale and cost effectiveness and logistics and all of those things. I mean, whatever you want to call those, implementation or whether it's worthy or not. So you could make the policy argument, like, is it better to fix disparities in acute stroke, or should we have mobile stroke units everywhere? Or really the right answer is do both, you know? But the question is, so right now, as it stands today, answer your question more directly, it cost about $1 million to basically get one of those rigs together. That's not that much, I would say, but it's about $1 million. I told you how most of the places are funding those things. As usual, the real cost is like the driver that you need, you know, in order to be able to, right? It's the people cost. So, but it's about $1 million. People, systems have done it to serve their community, to have it as a marketing advantage and a, for all the reasons that you can imagine. The ones that haven't done it because they haven't done it and, you know, whatever. So that's been the challenge. There isn't reimbursement people wonder if the numbers make sense. And then there has to be a set of champions to sort of put it together. Those have been some of the limitations. Here, I would say we've had some debate about what's the right answer, like the whole field has had. I'll tell you, we should do it. I've been pushing for it for the last 2 years. If you want to be a leader and also answer also whether or not it works and how it works, we should do it. So there's no question we should do it. In fact, what I would tell you is we should do one better, because with the mobile CT scanner, you have the problem of radiation. It's actually a bigger footprint. There are a lot of challenges with it. What we have in our hand is to take one of our mobile MRI, one of our portable MRI units. We have the most experience of any system in the world for now. They're smaller. They don't have radiation. Our postgraduate assistants run the machine, and you can scan in about 5 minutes. So we should put one of those in one of our ambulances and sell it out. And I got to tell you, I don't know. Join me in making it happen.
Okay. So thank you. So I'm wondering if you could say a comment about the bread and butter issues that we bread and butter issues that we have to face when we're managing a stroke patient. Because, you know, sometimes what you think is a good thing turns out to be counterintuitively the opposite. So what about things like oxygen management and glucose management and blood pressure management? Because I know at least like in the cardiac population, too much oxygen seems to have worse outcomes. So just some sort of standard questions that we have to face in managing these patients.
Yeah, I'll tell you, there's a simple answer to that question. After, I would say, especially within we didn't talk about it today, 2 decades of trials on each of those covariates, sort of one by one in very large numbers. And the bottom line ends up being, for oxygen, for glucose, for temperature, on all of those, just maintain the normal range. No benefit to changing. There's a lot of association data. There's been no causal data that modifying that really helps. So just keep it above 92%, keep them in a euglycemic range defined by your critical care guidelines, keep the temperature. We're going to publish a temperature modulation study that we led. It also had a neutral result along with everybody else. So it's just maintain euthermia, euhypoglycemia, that's the answer. On blood pressure, it is the same answer that especially in the acute stroke, permissive hypertension. You know, take the blood pressure meds off, give them a little bit to control their AFib, their rate if they have AFib, but otherwise permissive hypertension. That's probably the one concrete example where there's trial level evidence to say lowering is bad. And then I would say, the sodium. This is the one that always comes up. And I know it comes up a lot in a lot of the settings. There is zero data to prophylactically drive up sodiums in any acute neurological condition. And in fact, there's some preclinical data to suggest the immunomodulatory consequences may be deleterious. Okay, none. Manipulating sodium as a treatment option in the face of clinically relevant swelling, there is trial level evidence to do that. This business of needing to drive up preemptively to 150 or something, I gotta tell you, it's just been one of those things. Does that answer?
Yeah. Any other last questions or any chat business? No? No. All right. Well, thank you so much. We've learned so much.